something around the English. What else are
you? Just to give maybe just a quick, very brief highlight, I will be handing this over to the ED to talk more about it. The reason why we call you here today is to launch the Producer Relief Fund that we as a system with our partners have come together to see whether we can be able to respond to some of the emergency needs of our members, producers and workers. Yeah, so we have, as I already mentioned, workers spread across and producers who are impacted differently based on the countries where they are coming from. Yeah, so this fund in a little way will go into supporting some of the immediate.
How the flower farms have really been negatively impacted by COVID-19. Workers have lost their jobs. Some have been sent on unpaid leave because of the closure of borders, the closure of airports. The export has been negatively impacted, and the surge freight charges with a few cargo planes, freight charges have really gone up for flowers. There's been a decrease in price and demand in the consumer markets. You don't expect your European consumer to really now walk out of their house to go and buy flowers. That is not really a necessity. So that has impacted on the sales of flowers from Kenya, from Ethiopia, from Uganda, etc. So because of the changing consumption patterns, it's trickled down to affect that worker in Arusha, that worker in the flower farm in Eldama Ravine, that worker in the flower farms of Ethiopia, losing their jobs, going on unpaid leave, going on maybe paid leave, but only for a short time, and thereafter losing their jobs. So it's really, and of course, the business of the flower farms. So we find in Kenya, roughly speaking, that they have had a loss of 60% to 70% in their sales. So that is flowers, to give you an example from Eastern Africa. If I go to Western Africa, where we also have our farmers and workers, cocoa in Ghana and in cocoa in Cote d'Ivoire. The world cocoa prices have gone down. What effect does this have? The effect has actually been estimated by the Ghanaian government that there will be an estimated loss to them of $1 billion. I go south to South Africa, wine. There have been loss of jobs, there have been temporary retrenchments, mostly because of disruption in production and export. When COVID-19 started in South Africa, the government banned export for some time. Now it's been lifted, but the impact of that time that it was banned is still going to affect the wine farmers for some time. Because at that point in time, they were not earning, but they still had to pay workers and pay all their bills. So I just wanted to give an example of really how COVID-19 has impacted on various members of constituencies. So given this, and given the fact that it is important that we all stay safe, we as Fairtrade, we decided that as Fairtrade, we must stand together. We must stand together with our farmers and workers. And our Fairtrade International led the way by last month launching a relief fund to address the needs of farmers and workers in Latin America, in Africa, and in Asia. And we as Fairtrade Africa, we also said we have to stand together with the farmers and workers of Africa. As such, we embarked on raising money to try and see how we can support these vulnerable farmers and workers. So far, we have been lucky that we've managed to raise 600,000. Actually, by yesterday it was 600,000. Today, this morning when we came to the office, we found another 100,000. So we are really talking about 700,000 euros that we have raised towards this. What do we plan to do with this money? our producers have written to us asking for support in various ways. The demand that there is, we really cannot meet. The demand is too huge. So what we've done is we've narrowed down to two areas that we want to support producers in. And this is first, to protect. So here we're talking about health and safety. So we're talking about the purchase of masks, we're talking about sanitizers, we're talking about hand washing facilities, etc., etc. Issues related to health and safety. Because if we don't protect ourselves first and foremost, we will not be able to do anything else. So the farmers and workers need to protect themselves first and foremost. And this is where we come in to support them. Second, the second area that we want to intervene in is awareness creation. Because a lot of the problems in the spread of COVID-19 is because of ignorance. It's because people don't know what to do. You see us here wearing masks. As you walk the streets of Nairobi or drive through the streets of Nairobi or go into a building, how many people do you see like this? Very many. Very many. Ignorance. Not washing their hands, not doing so many things to protect themselves. It's not that they don't want to in most cases, it's because they do not know. And this has been brought to our attention also by our farmers and workers. And they've asked us, how can you assist us to create more awareness in our communities about protection against COVID-19? So the awareness creation can be through distribution information material. Information material is there. From governments, various governments, from WHO, information is not lacking. It's distributing that information so that the average person on the ground has access to that information. We have producer organizations who are partnering with local radio stations to create awareness. But of course, that costs money. So we are also supporting them in that. We have interventions like that from Kagera in Tanzania, where they're using the local radio station. We have a community in Cote d'Ivoire doing the same thing. So there are various examples everywhere. So we want more and more of our producer organizations to be able to partner with local radio stations that use the indigenous languages to spread awareness against COVID-19. So those are the two main areas that this relief fund is going to address. It is just a beginning. We're not saying that there's not much more to do. Of course, there's much more to do. But of course, with limited resources, you have to prioritize. So we've prioritized those two areas. I can give you an example of how big the demand is. When we reached out to our producers to ask them, where would you need support? The applications we got within a period of, I think, 3 weeks was worth 2.1 million euros. That was the ask. But we have 700,000 in the pot. So we are going to start distributing that this week. We start distributing this week 250,000 euros. And as we look at the applications that have come in, we'll continue the distribution, but we'll not only continue the distribution of the funds, we are also continuing on fundraising to see how we can go as close as possible, if not surpass, the 2.1 million euro demand. So I must say, and must thank our partners who are coming together with us to raise these funds. The 700,000 has come both from the Fairtrade International system, from us as an organization, Fairtrade Africa, but also from our partners. And we are confident that our partners will continue supporting us in this call for relief. Finally, I'd like to stress that, of course, relief is not the mainstay of our calling. But these are special times, asking for special measures. We're not a humanitarian organization. We're not a development organization. We're a trade organization. It is trade, not aid. But COVID has brought us to a certain space that you cannot ignore the needs of our farmers and workers. They need to be healthy, first and foremost, before they can even trade. So that is why, as Fairtrade, we stand together. So as we come from, as we still continue the relief intervention, we also have a second part of our intervention that after relief, what next? Resilience. Resilience, because we have no idea. Will COVID happen again? Will there be something else? So how can our farmers and workers be more resilient? So we are also at the same time raising funds for a resilience fund. And maybe for a little bit of more details on these resilience funds, I'd like to hand over to Madeline to tell us a few and explain to us what the resilience fund is all about. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nyagoe. As Dr. Nyagoe has mentioned, we are saving lives first by doing relief and emergency. But after that, you've heard that the impact of COVID on the lives of workers and farmers will be long-term. And we don't even know how it will look. So this second fund, the Resilience Fund, is to support business to continue. How do we ensure that business continues? We've already mentioned that we are a trade organization, not a humanitarian organization. So our call is to help the producers be able to support themselves. So we are looking at the medium-term and long-term measures to secure the livelihoods, the businesses that the workers have, develop their food chains and resilience food chains as well, value chains, diversification of their incomes, so invest. So we are looking to invest in opportunities to diversify their income sources for the workers and the farmers, and also for the producer organizations. But also diversify crops. We've talked about coffee, cocoa. What else can they do to be able to survive, to be able to restore their livelihoods? We'll be looking to invest in the second fund now, once we finish with resilience, in alternative income generating activities, but also invest, for example, in education projects, in health projects as well, for the children of the workers and of the farmers. But we're also looking, so now we're calling on our partners to help us raise additional funding into this second pot. This 600,000 goes into the first pot, the relief fund. So the second work stream now we're looking, we're already beginning to raise funding to support our workers and farmers now for the long term to be able to secure them.